Welcome everyone. I think it looks like participant number stabilized. So yeah, welcome everyone to this webinar. We're very excited to have the YouGlab today here presenting the CARE tools, and they promised us a lot of exciting features. And we've here is that, like, of course, Florian Jug and then Tim Buchholz, Mangal Prakash and Deborah Schmidt and Alex Krull from the YouGlab. And then we have on the more on the managing side of New Bias Academy, we have Nuno is also in the YouGlab, and then Rocco and me, and we have also Kurt Andersen, who is kindly hosting this entire session. And I would like to ask you to ask your questions in the Q&A window and to use the chat only for technical problems that you have. So please use the Q&A for any content related questions. And with that, I stop sharing and pass over to the YUK group. Have fun.
Thank you, Anna, very much for your introduction. I will now share my screen and kick off this webinar about a beginner's guide to quantitative image restoration. The webinar today will show a number of very well-known functionalities and also a number of things that we only pushed out in the last couple of days. We used this invitation by New Bias to give this webinar as a motivator for us to kind of release new versions and new features. And today we run you through a number of those. The first thing that is brand new since tonight is a complete revamp of the csbdbioimagecomputing.com website. And I will start by showing you this website a tiny bit. It doesn't matter if you know the old website or not. It was useful, but it was not so image analyst centric. And the new website really puts the question, what can I do with my data in the center? So CSPDeep is a deep learning toolbox for microscopists, and you can do many things with it. So if you ask the question, what can I do with my data? Then here we have image restoration and multiple examples of what you can do. We have image restoration also if you only have noisy images or only single noisy images, and then also some examples for object detection. We will speak about a subset of these things today, but if I show you now one example, you go onto this example, you see a before and after image, you know who authored the method, what is the used method, it's actually CARE, and if you click on it, you come to these available tools, and you see a bunch of links that point in different places in the internet where this information was already available for many months. The nice thing now is that there is like a central place where you can start your investigations about the methods we offer. And we is not only the YouGlab, but a bunch of people that contribute to the CSPDeep tool set. If you go on the available tools, you see that currently we host four very different types of tools. If you, for example, click on noise to void, which is one of the things we will speak about today, then you find a gallery and again, credits, videos, tons of things are here. But you will also, for at least three of the four tools, you find setup instructions and exercise sheets. And they might be interesting for you after the webinar. If you are interested and you want to learn more about how to do these things, this might be valuable resources for you to start learning about these tools. Okay, let me go back to the presentation. Today's speakers are, in order of appearance, Alex Krull, Tim, Deborah, and Mangal. And what we speak about is things that we worked on in the last years, but it would not be possible to speak about all these things if there would not be many other people's contributing too. So here we picked six very important ones for the content of today's seminar, but at the very end, we will have to give credits to a bunch of more people. Really important is to mention that Martin and Uwe are like really of uttermost importance for the entire CSPDeep library, and Coleman also authored a methodological contribution we will showcase today. But since we are already five speakers, we kind of cut it with us five and cover for Coleman. Then the last three names here are research software engineers, and their heroic efforts really bring this bleeding edge technology into Fiji or into Jupyter Notebooks in a way that it's usable by many more people than just like the researchers around the world. So enough preamble. What is happening? There is an introduction ongoing by yours truly. And then we will hear two main blocks, where we first will hear about content-aware image restoration by Alex, Tim, and Devo. And then the second block will be slightly shorter and will present a new tool called denoisec, which is also a denoising method, but at the same time does also segment the data. With this, I have only one thing more to do. And that is, I want to tell you what you will not learn and what you, and I give you a short introduction to one thing that you will also not hear much about, but at least it will help you to understand today's presentations a bit better. So what you will not learn today is you will not learn how to install Python or Jupyter on your machine. There were other new BIOS events, and the internet is full of useful resources. We are very happy to help you there too. But this webinar will not cover this. It will also not cover how to install TensorFlow or Keras with GPU support on your machine. We expect that you either know this already, have done this already, or will do that in the future on your own account. We will also not speak much about Jupyter in general. There were also other very good NuBIOS training school events, virtual events happening in the last few months that speak more about this. I will, though, very quickly run through examples. So I assume that many of you have used Jupyter before, but if you happen to be one of the people that never used it, I will at least enable you to understand the rest of this webinar. If you start Jupyter Notebook after installing it, then in your browser, you get this environment. This is this notebook environment. And what you see here is all the files that are in the folder where you started Jupyter Notebooks. And I just created a demo notebook just to run you through the most important things. A Jupyter Notebook is essentially source code, but the nice thing is the source code is grouped in small cells of code that you can either execute by clicking on this run button or by hitting shift, holding shift and hitting enter. Then you see this asterisk here, meaning this cell is currently interpreted by Python. And these code cells, they can be interleaved with formatted text cells. They just show you that something here is maybe not so important. So shift enter, we can just go over it, shift enter, and everything works. So if you want to know what happened here, although it says it's pointless and maybe you want to ignore it, then if you read it, it is just Python. So if that troubles you, it should not matter either, because many of the notebooks you will get in contact in the next hour or so, they are written in such a way that the formatted text on top points you to all the things that might be relevant for you. And if you just let the rest be, and with intelligent pattern matching, just find the places where you want to change something. For example, you want really to blur it less, then it's kind of obvious that this is a Gaussian filter on the loaded image. And if you change the sigma to something else, you see, without really programming, just following this with like intelligent pattern matching and just the willingness to mess around a bit, you will have absolutely no problem. This is now really the end of what I'm going to show as an introduction. And next up is the first block. It will maybe be roughly 30 minutes. And after these 30 minutes, we will have one break for answering a few questions that we think are important enough to answer in the plenum so that everybody hears the question and the answer, and then go on to the second block. So Alex, please entertain us with the theory part about care, noise to noise, and noise to void.
Hello, everybody. So I hope you can see my screen. I will tell you today about the different methods for image restorations that have been developed at MPI-CVG and in the UCLAB in particular. So I know that many of you face the dilemma of having to find the sweet spot between using a low exposure, which might be gentle for your sample, but will also give you a poor signal to noise ratio, and using a higher exposure, which might give nice images, but might endanger your sample. So luckily, with help from Martin Weigert and Uwe Schmidt, deep learning came along and provided a black box for us called the CNN that takes a low exposure image and transforms it into something that looks very much like a high exposure image you see here on the right. However, these systems, these neural networks, have hundreds of thousands to millions of parameters that have to be tuned in a process called training. So traditionally, this is what we call care training. This process starts with two stacks of corresponding clean and noisy images. We feed our noisy images into the network. Here, this is shown in a 1D fashion. The network outputs some kind of prediction, and we can now compare this prediction with the corresponding clean target. We can calculate a discrepancy between the two. We call this discrepancy the loss, and we can tune the parameters of our network to minimize this loss. And if we do this for enough iterations and for long enough, the network will actually learn to denoise noisy images. However, there is a slight caveat here, namely we need this paired kind of training data. We need pairs of noisy and clean images. And in particular, it can be difficult to acquire clean images for some type of experiments and for some type of data. Sometimes it's impossible. So a different way to train your networks is called noise to noise. This was introduced by Lettinen et al. It's not our work, but and this is a way that allows you to train your network using pairs of noisy images, which do not require clean data. So in noise to noise, you assume that your noisy image as it comes from your microscope is just a sum of a clean signal, which you want to recover, plus some noise, which you would like to remove. Now, in noise to noise training, you start out with two stacks of corresponding noisy images. And what does this mean? These two stacks share the same signal, but have different instantiations of the noise. So in practice, this would mean, for example, you could acquire such an image pair by just in quick succession recording two images with your microscope, hoping that in between nothing moved in your sample. So then the underlying signal should be the same while the noise is a different instance. Now we can do the exact same training procedure. We can feed the noisy image into the network, produce some kind of output, and minimize the discrepancy to the target. And again, surprisingly maybe, the network will learn to denoise the image. So why is this? How can this work? So I can only give you a brief intuition. Since the signal is the same in both images, this noisy input image contains information about the signal, but it does not contain information about the noise that it's supposed to predict. So the network has to solve an impossible task, and the best compromise it can come up with is actually a good solution for denoising. However, here is still a problem in practice because we still require training images, and there are situations where it's difficult to acquire even noisy pairs of images, where you only have individual noisy images. And this is where the method that we developed in the UCLAB 2019 comes in, that we call noise to void. So again, we use the same setup, but we make additional assumptions about the nature of your signal In particular, we assume that your signal is in a way predictable in that sense that by looking, you can get a reasonable prediction for the value at a pixel in your signal by looking at its surroundings. This is just a way of saying that your signal is something different from random white noise, right? There is some structure in the signal you would like to recover. For the noise, we make an equal but opposite assumption. We assume that it is impossible to produce a prediction for the value of the noise at a pixel by looking at its surroundings. So in noise to void training, we start with a single stack of noisy images. We feed them into the network, and the network will produce some kind of output, but now we want to take a different perspective. We want to look inside this network and we want to see how the prediction for an individual pixel is created by the network. If we do this, we see that the prediction for this pixel here actually depends only on a limited range of input pixels around it. And this is what we call the network's receptive field, the pixel's receptive field. So what do you think would happen now if I take the same noisy input image and use it as input, but also as target? So if we simply go ahead and we do this, and we train the network to minimize the loss, the network will actually only learn to always forward the central pixel of its receptive field to its output. In effect, this just means that the network has learned the identity. So this means it will always output exactly what you put in. This is not helpful for denoising. So in noise to void, we came up with an idea to solve this that we call the blind spot network. And the idea here is to modify the receptive field of the network in such a way that it cannot use the information at the central pixel. So we introduce a blind spot here. And a network that has this type of receptive field, when we train it in the same fashion, it will actually learn to denoise the image. So how is this possible? Remember the two assumptions that we made earlier. For the noise, it is impossible to predict what is the value of the noise in the blind spot by looking at the surroundings. But for the signal, we can make a reasonable prediction for the signal at the pixel by looking at the surroundings. So how can we create a network that has this type of receptive field? Well, you can go ahead and you can engineer a network architecture that achieves this, and people have done that. We chose a different direction. We use what we call masking. So here we have the same image as input and as target, but the trick here is to not use all the pixels in the calculation of the loss, but just a randomly selected subset. And we calculate the loss only for those randomly selected pixels. But in the input, exactly these pixels are masked and are made invisible for the network. So noise to void can achieve some quite remarkable results, like you see here. But the most important feature that you should remember with about noise to void is that in order to produce this type of results, we do not have to go to the microscope to acquire additional training data. We can use the very same data that we want to denoise in the first place. And it can serve as training data, and then subsequently we can denoise it. So here I want to give a quick overview about the things that the different methods I've talked about can achieve and what they cannot achieve. So I have already talked about the type of noise that you get when you have low light imaging. It's Poisson shot noise and readout noise that happens per pixel. And the traditional care that uses paired training data can do pretty well here. But you can also do other things with it. If you have the adequate training data, you can try to increase the resolution of your data. If you have pairs of high resolution and low resolution images, you can also do deconvolution in the same way. And finally, if you have, like some people who are in the unfortunate situation of having to deal with JPEG compression artifacts, problems like this, then in principle, you can also use a supervised approach like CARE to help you out with this, if you have the adequate paired training data. Now, for methods like noise to void, it's different. Because for the per pixel noise, we can do use the type of data that I've explained to you, and we can do two successive recordings of the same scene under the microscope to produce the training data. But for deconvolution or to increase the resolution, you cannot produce this type of data. And the same goes for noise to void. We make very specific assumptions about the noise, that it has to happen per pixel. And we cannot use this scheme to increase the Z resolution or to do deconvolution. Yeah, so with this, I want to hand you back over to Tim, who will now tell you something about how you can actually use these methods in practice that I've introduced.
Thank you. All right. Yes, thank you, Alex. I will talk about the practical approaches and how you can get started with CSV Deep and these tools. And as Florian already mentioned, the entry point is the new website, and we can go here to what can I do with my data, and we see these scenarios. And for this example, I will choose this denoising in 2D for noisy and clean images, so the traditional care approach. Again, here some information on how to install it, and down here the link to the Jupyter notebooks, which you can use to reproduce these results. Now I've already downloaded these Jupyter notebooks and started the Jupyter server. And here we are in CSV Deep, examples, denoising 2D. And all care workflows consist of three Jupyter notebooks, the data generation, here, data gen, the training notebook, and the prediction notebook. And we start with the data generation, and everything we do here is we collect the data on which we want to train our model. So in this example, we want to go from low quality 2D images to high quality 2D images, and we have to organize this data in a way that CSV Deep is able to read it and handle it for the network training. How do we do that? Well, we put all our low quality images into a directory in data/train/low, and all our high quality images we put into another directory in data/train/gt. GT stands for ground truth. And you can see this here. I have data, then I have train, and in here I have these two subdirectories, low and GT, and in here I would have these many, many images. It is important that the corresponding images have exactly the same name, because the name is used internally to match these image pairs together. So if I open up this Jupyter notebook, the data generation, you can see, yes, this is the corresponding example. We do some import, so I will not go over this and execute the cells, I will just talk about it. Here we download the example data, and then the first thing we do, we display two example images just to verify that we are actually using the data we want to denoise later on. After that, we use the functionality from CSV Deep to load our data from this data/train from the low directory and from the GT directory. Once we have the data loaded, we use this functionality to extract patches of size 128 by 128 pixels. And after they are extracted, they get saved into this file in data/mytrainingdata.npc. And if you go here, you can see I've executed this. I go here back to data. You see here this file, mytrainingdata.npc, which contains all these extracted patches. The last thing that happens in this notebook, we display a couple of these patches just to verify that the corresponding patch pairs are correct. And this is it for the data generation notebook. And with this, we would come to the next notebook, the training notebook. And the first thing that happens in the training notebook is we load the patches which we generated in the first notebook. You can see we have low quality image patches and high quality image patches. And we also call them input or X or target or Y. So we want to train a network from X to Y. The next thing we do in this training notebook is we split the data into two sets. A bigger one, the actual training data, which usually takes up 95% or sometimes 90 or 80%. And the remaining percentage of data we use as validation data. The validation data is used during training as an independent control to measure the accuracy of our model on unseen data. So once we have split up our training data into these two sets, we can define our model, and then we can start training by passing to the train function of the model the training data x and y, and the validation data x val and y val. And once training is complete, we will end up with these nice curves. So here we have the loss curves. The blue curve is computed only on the training data, and the orange curve is computed only on the validation data. And if your curves after training look something like this, everything went well. You can see that the losses are going down, and towards the end, the validation loss reaches this plateau and converges nicely. Now, sometimes it can happen that your validation loss shoots back up into the sky. And we call this overfitting. So what is happening? The network does a really, really good job on the training data. You can see here, the loss gets smaller and smaller and smaller, but on the validation data, it does a really poor job. This is because it never sees the validation data, and it's kind of just remembering the training data. And this would be a really bad network if we would use this one from the last epochs. In this case, we actually want to use the network which has the best validation loss, and best means the lowest validation loss. Luckily, CSPD takes care of this and saves not only the weights from the last epoch, but also the weights from the best epochs. And by default, it actually loads the best network, so corresponding to the lowest validation loss. And with this, we are basically done with the training notebook, and we come to the last part, which is the prediction. I have here the prediction notebook, and this is a really short notebook. Again, we have to do some imports. We load some data, which we now want to denoise. So we have another noisy image. In this case, we also have the ground truth, because later on we want to compare how well it actually works on unseen data. Then we load our model, and you can see here, by default, it loads the best weights corresponding to the best validation loss. And after this, it's just calling model predict on our noisy image X, and we get the restored image back. But the last thing in this notebook is a comparison of our low quality input, the restoration with care, and here we have the ground truth image to have a comparison on how well the care job is done. And this is the basic care workflow. So now to summarize and give you some tips. So if it's the first time that you're doing deep learning or image restoration in this setting, we can highly recommend that you just take one of these example notebooks and execute it cell by cell. So you start a notebook, hit shift, enter, and go through all the cells and see how everything works. And the first time, or the first two or three times, this can take a couple hours, and you should just take your time, take an afternoon off, and step through all these notebooks and try to read all the comments and understand what is happening in the cells. And maybe the exercise sheets from the website are helpful for you as well. And once you step through these notebooks and feel familiar with what is happening, you can go a step further and start replacing the example data with your own data. And you would do this by going here into the train directory and replace the images in these folders, low and GT, with your own data. Just make sure that the names are actually the same, because this is what is needed for the matching. If you have done this and everything seems to work out fine, you can go another step further and experiment with different settings. For example, here in the training notebook, if you go to the network configuration, you see there are many, many hyperparameters, and you can play around with these and figure out, maybe you find a setting which works better for your data. But in general, these default parameters, they work quite well for many different types of data. And if you have problems or questions, just go to the new website or ask the question on the forum. And with this, I'm at the end of the care workflow, and I will now go over to the noise to void workflow, which is almost the same, but there's a slight difference. In the noise to, sorry, I have to drink quickly. All right. In the noise to void workflow, we only have two steps. We have the training and we have the prediction. The reason for this is that noise to void, we don't really need pairs of low quality and high quality images. We just can use our noisy images. And this makes the whole data preparation much simpler, and we just put it inside of the training notebook. I have here one of the notebooks open. This is the noise to void 2D example on SEM data. And again, it follows the same principle. You can step through this notebook by hitting shift and enter. We download some data, and then we open these images. And the only thing we have to do, we have to extract training patches and validation patches. And you can see we don't have any ground-proof targets here because they are not needed for noise to void. Once we have the patches, we can start creating our network and start the training by passing X and Y to the train function. And after training, you again get these plots of the loss curves. And even though they look really converged here already after a few epochs, you really have to train them for many, many epochs, because the noise to void training gets better and better and better over time, even though it looks like it's already done after 5 epochs. So training such a network for 4 or 6 hours or just overnight is really the best you can do. And here I would like to talk about the export of such a trained model with the BioImage Model Zoo format. And you can do this by executing this cell, and this will generate a zip file called export.bioimage.io.zip, which I can find this zip file here at this location. And the cool thing is I can now take the zip file and send it to one of my collaborators, to one of my users, if I'm working in a facility, and this user can just use this trained model and apply to her or his own data. Another cool thing is you can do this training. For example, I did it here in Python. I exported this model and I now send it to Deborah, who will talk next, and she will show you how she can use this trained model in Fiji to predict on her own data. All right, model gets sent.
Okay, hello everyone. I'm going to talk about how our tools are integrated in Fiji, and I'm not sure if I'm already sharing my screen. Am I?
No.
No. All right. Now I am. So you might have noticed that the file that Tim just showed you ended with bioimage.io.zip. And I just want to show you this website quickly. It's called bioimage.io. So there's a reason for that naming, and that is that there's an initiative, the BioImage Model Zoo, which is built on top of ImpJoy, and it's a big collaboration between ImpJoy, Elastic, ImageJ in Fiji. And this is supposed to be a place where you can store and share your pre-trained models, and where you can also find models that fit your data. And this is a big task. This is currently under heavy development, and we are joining the force. And with this model that we can already share now between Python and Fiji, we are taking one step closer to being able to share the models here on this model zoo as well. And if you go to the site, you will already see a few models here, and one of this was trained in Fiji. So this will be most useful, for example, for facilities, as Tim just mentioned, where someone is doing the training and other people just want to do prediction. Okay, everything I'm showing you now, you will also find on our website again. So I will go here to available tools and then to noise to void. That's just what we talked about. And there is a link, it's called How to Use Noise to Void in Fiji, which will lead us to the ImageJ wiki, which has a whole site about noise to void in ImageJ. And the first section here is about how to install it. And the only thing you need now is the CSV deep update site. So the changed in comparison to the first version, The CSV Deep update site includes the CSV Deep tools, the care tools, and also noise to void and denoisec. And that's really all you need. Of course, you need more if you want GPU support. I will not show you this, but I made the page with all the tips and tricks that we somehow collected. I hope that helps. I know it's not that easy for some hardware systems. For others, it was really easy. You have to keep in mind that these TensorFlow native libraries for Java that we are using are considered experimental, and that not many people are doing training of Keras model in Java. But if there are any issues for you, please let us know in the forum and we will try to help you here. Okay. If we go now back to the overview, then you will see that there's also a point called export trained models from Python to ImageJVG. And if you click on that, there's a very short list of things to do. The first thing we just saw, calling model.export TensorFlow in Python. Then you locate the exported model, and then you can just proceed as described in the prediction section. And I will not go through this with you now, but I will show you one of the ways of running prediction directly in Fiji. So I'm starting it, and I can open a model by pressing File, Import, BioImageIO.zip, and then just choosing the model that I pre-trained before in Python or in Fiji. And then I open another image, which fits this data. This is also an SEM data set, bigger one, and all I have to do is press predict and wait for a couple of moments. This is now real time, so you see it takes a bit, but not that long. And I will add the progress window soon. So this is the result. It looks really nice. And that's all you need to do. Now, I was lying before. This was not trained in Python. This was actually trained in Fiji. And how was this done? As you heard before, that for noise to void, you can train on a single image like this one. It's big enough, but if you have more data, you can also choose this command train on folder, but we will now use the one-click solution called train and predict, which trains on this one image and also predicts it afterwards. So we click this, we can choose the default values, and during training, there are two windows open, which guide you through the process. You can just watch the process here. The one in the middle is showing the training, and the validation loss is just the same as we saw in the notebooks before. And on the right, you see the prediction, what the network currently thinks is the denoised version during training. And then you get the result. This took now in total 6 hours roughly. So this is a speed version, of course. But as you saw before, prediction goes really smooth, and you take your time, you let it train long enough, then you can really benefit for prediction then. And I will show you later how to reuse this model when I show the next tool. And with that, we talk now about care and noise to void. And there's one cool new addition to noise to void, and this is something that Alex is now going to talk about.
Hello again. All right. Yeah, so I will talk about what we call structured noise to void that can help you with to deal with more difficult types of noise. So this is a paper that was conceived published by Coleman as the first author. And we noticed that when we want to denoise certain types of images acquired by some specific microscopes, noise to void sometimes does not work as well as we expect it to. For example, in this image here, the denoised version does look arguably a lot better, but still, especially if you look at the background regions,
you see that there's still a lot of structure where there should be a flat surface, hopefully. So why is noise to void not able to remove this? If we take a close look of the, at the type of noise that we have here in the original raw image, and yeah, you can see this if you look really closely, if you look horizontally through the pixels and vertically through the pixels, you see that they are actually not the same. So this noise is structured horizontally. And this is unfortunately something that the microscope, this particular microscope, involuntarily produces. Ideally, it should not, but in reality, we have this kind of problems. So this noise does not happen per pixel. It's actually violating the assumption that we make with noise to void. And this means that noise to void will not be able to recognize it as noise and remove it, but it will like produce this type of result. So what can we do to combat this? So you remember that we use the masking strategy, like the one I show here, to produce these blind spots during training. So we randomly select pixels and calculate the loss only for those randomly selected pixels, which are masked in the input. Now, if the noise is predictable, which it is in this case, by looking at the surroundings of the pixel, we get the bad results that we saw before. So the solution that Coleman came up was to, instead of masking just this pixel, additionally masking a bigger area around it. And if we do this, we can get much improved results. So here I show again for comparison, this is the normal noise to void result. And if we use Coleman's method, you see that you get a much nicer result for this type of data. So we have on our CSP Deep website also examples of this, which you can look at. Yes, and now I think we are in for some question time.
Yes. I'm not 100% sure how we proceed now. We are answering questions all the time in the chat and on the system that is provided by Nubias. I have multiple of the questions that we also answered in the chat labeled as being interesting for everyone. So if maybe one of the other panelists could read them out loud, I don't know if Rocco or Nuno, you feel motivated to do that. Because otherwise I have to read their own question that then I will go to answer, which is slightly awkward. But I can do that as well. Yeah, I see nodding faces, so I guess I read the questions. So, dear Nuno, not really. I was hoping somebody here might know of a good page. Aha, the question here was, can you please on your website also point us at good instructions of how to install Python, Jupyter, TensorFlow, Keras, and all these things? The reason why we don't have this on our website yet is that depending if you are on a Windows machine, if your Windows machine is new or old, what GPU you have, these instructions might need to be different. I'm not aware of a single page that kind of would serve all our users. And so if we, instead of having a single beautiful page, which would be really, really great, we put there 20 different pages, then we didn't solve the problem. We just shifted the problem from the internet onto our page in the internet. So if anybody in the audience thinks, no, but wait, recently I found this page, which in my point of view is just amazing, then we would be extremely grateful if you could send an email to us or contact us in any other way and let us know. We will then check this page. And if we think that it is indeed a page that is doing the trick for many users, we would absolutely link at it. Next question. If my samples are robust enough, is it best to train a care network or go with noise to void? I think, so would it be less work for the experimenter? How do care and noise to noise and noise to void perform compared to each other on the same data? Alex, maybe you can answer this question.
Yes, so I can answer it. And maybe I can even show, if I share my screen.
Oh, you answered super professional. Go ahead.
Yeah, yeah, always answer super professionally. So here's like a comparison of noise to void, and we compare PSNR values. So high PSNR value is good. And on the x-axis, you see the amount of noise that we added to the images. And these are different types of denoising methods that we have. And the white one is noise to void. Now, what we call traditional here is care. And you see that noise to void is worse, right? And somehow naturally, right? Because we are using less information, right? We have this blind spot. And the traditional network does not have it, right? It can use the full range of the receptive field. So we're at a disadvantage, but you also see that the more noise you add, the smaller this gap becomes. And if you have more noise, you will actually more closely approach the traditional care training. And intuitively, this also makes sense, because if you have a ton of noise, then it is not so severe to disregard a single pixel, right? But if you imagine the other extreme, where you have basically no noise, most of the important information is actually in the one pixel that you occlude.
Cool.
So this is basically the gap that we have.
The next question is kind of related, I would think. Or is there something that you are burning to add?
Yeah, I would just want to add one more thing to it. We are developing newer methods that are also unsupervised, like noise to void, that manage to narrow this. This is just something I want to say.
Ah, yeah, yeah. We will speak about it even later. We will hear in about half an hour or so, we will hear about methods that come, that are also in this gap. It's usually not that we can be better than care, but they narrow it. And I think from a user perspective, the person asking the question is absolutely right. If you do not have to create ground truth images, and sometimes this is not even possible, then the propensity of you choosing noise to void is higher, right? If you cannot get ground truth, care does not apply, right? If it is difficult.
There's also the danger of having bad ground truth, right? So it could be that the only type of ground truth you can produce is actually not really good. Yes. For example, if your sample moves, right?
Yes. So the noise to void video you showed, for example, the one example movie, these processes that were imaged there are so fast that if you try to make the same image content, image it a second time at better quality, the individual puncture being in this, that we saw in these images, they would already move around. And then the ground truth image, even having good quality, doesn't match the first acquisition anymore. So all these kinds of problems can go wrong with care. So we have to move on, because there are some more questions that we would like to work on. The next question is somewhat related. At least the answers are. Is there a general guideline on how many sets of images we need to train an accurate CNN? 100 pairs, 500 pairs? And does the number of pairs of images depend on the signal and noise? And the answer is hard to say how much data you need. And yes, it depends on the signal. And yes, it depends on the noise. So in general, why is it hard to give an answer? If all your images look more or less the same, if it is like a simple data set that is not confusing and the noise is very little, then you need not many examples to see many examples to get a good feeling for how to denoise these images as a network. If on the other hand, you image something that like EM images, right? Scanning electron microscopy, very many different structures are in your data set. Then you also need to see many more examples because of the diversity of the imaging landscape, so to say, right? If on top of that, you also have huge amounts of noise, then you need to see even more data in order to kind of be more sure what the heck is going on in your data. So this kind of, I think, makes it clear why the answer is difficult, right? I move on to the next one that says, care images often look even better, smoother than the ground truth. How does this happen? And here I would like to use this, the answer is giving you only a cliffhanger. When we continue after this Q&A, we will hear about noise to noise. And stay tuned, because that is exactly the answer to your question. The ground truth is not really ground truth. It's just a lesser noisy version of the same image. And so the noise to noise is the answer, by the care prediction can be of even higher quality than the ground truth itself. or even smoother. So what is the influence of the patch size on the output? Meaning, does it affect, I cannot read the whole thing. Need to enlarge. Nunu, can you help me? Yeah, awesome. Does it make a difference if I use a 32 by 32 pixel or 64 by 64 pixel regarding the construction quality? This is a very detailed question. So it asks, there is a parameter in training our networks that says what size patches do I cut out of the images, and then we only during training feed these like smaller patches. The default settings should be enough. Why would one ever want to cut bigger patches? If you change the network in such a way that the so-called receptive field of a node in a network gets larger, then these patches can become too small. And why would you want to increase the receptive field size? You want that if your data you want to denoise is more complicated. So the default settings, again, for the people that are new to this, should, you know, suffice in most cases. If you see that the network cannot come up with a convincing restoration, then it might be that you need to give each pixel a bigger context to see, so that the content awareness can kind of refer to a larger portion of the neighboring pixels. And that is an advanced thing, and I cannot fully explain all facets of this question, but it's a very good question. Where have I been? Question about noise to void. So Alex, I think you can already kind of get in the starting position to answer. In the first live cell example, the restoration is really impressive, but I also noticed some artifacts in the less bright regions. It looks like the cells are dancing and or reshaping their nuclei all the time, which could lead to false conclusions. I've seen this artifact more clearly on my own data. With 2 second intervals, the nuclei should not move. This raises the question, how can you know when to trust the recording images? So this is a very loaded question, and when to be a bit skeptical. I give a few answers right away, then maybe Alex wants to fill in some things. When should you be skeptical? Always. You should always be skeptical, right? You always should look at the result as if you want to show that it didn't work well, and then convince yourself that the results are actually amazing. That is what I do every single time and what you should probably do as well. Then you said that there were artifacts in the background. I wouldn't trust a video played in PowerPoint on Alex's computer transmitted via Zoom onto your screen, right? All kinds of things that you have seen might not really be there. But you also said you saw similar things on your own data. We would very much appreciate if you go to the forum or if you go to the GitHub repository of the tool you used, you open an issue and you give us a link to your data and you describe these artifacts, because we are very keen on learning about these things. And many people approach us with such problems, and what typically turns out is that there is a very clear explanation of how these artifacts came to place, and often they're not artifacts. What you say about the timing in the movie, it was not a real-time movie, right? The imaging experiment was going much, much longer, and we just showed a movie at a 2 second frame rate. So the reshaping of the nuclei and the positioning of the, it's not MS2, but the transcription events, the timing was very different than what you saw. Maybe I now took all away from you, Alex, or do you want to add something?
Yeah, maybe one thing I can add is that I think you produced the data, Florian, right? So denoise the data, yeah, right? True. So
but the data is from ETH, from Stephanie. Yes.
And I think you did it like taking each image from the movie and separately processing it, correct? Yeah. Right. So, and this means that yes, so generally, yes, general consideration, the system, the network will try to make the best prediction given that image, right? And the image is very noisy, so it cannot be 100% sure. It cannot look into the future, into the past, like you can, right? When you
looking through the movie. And what does help in practice and gives better results in general is if you actually treat this stack of movie as a 3D volume, right? And we have had very good experiences with doing that. So if you have a 2D movie, it can make a lot of sense to pretend it's just a 3D volume and train a network to denoise it.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Alex. So this brings us to the last question. We have to hurry up a bit to not get into trouble with the 1.5 hours. But I'm so grateful that you ask all these questions because these are all very important points. And the next one is also a very important question. How useful are the model one can find online? For example, from the bioimage model zoo. Since I thought that each model is supposed to be only used for the type of data and the single microscope that the data was acquired for that we used for training, right? I think the question is clear. The answer is they are only useful, in my point of view, they are only useful if they were uploaded there for you, trained on your data or on the data that your colleague acquired, but on the same microscope with exactly the same setup and the same sample prep and everything. We do generally not suggest ever to use a model trained by someone on your own data. And there are exceptions to this rule, but the precondition for these exceptions to be allowed is that you are a professional, that you are really, that you know what you are doing. If you are new to this, or if you are really only a user that is not doing research in this direction, just don't do it. We put so much effort into bringing these technologies to Fiji, bringing training to Fiji, making the Jupyter notebooks as simple as possible. It is painful the first time. The first day, you will most likely use swear words. But in the evening of that day, you know how to train these networks. And then doing it again is just boring and just takes time, but it is easy. So I would not do any transfer of restoration models. I would not suggest it. Debo, you are nodding. Did I forget something? Is this a good answer? Then let's hurry up. I share my screen and we jump into the next deep dive. Poof, here and play. So this was the question Q&A, first Q&A session. Now we'll speak about one of the latest additions in the CSP Deep toolbox. And this edition is called Denoisec. And Mangal will first entertain us with a theory part so that we know what the heck is going on behind the scenes. And then we will also hear from Mangal how this looks in Jupyter. And then Debo will take over again and show you how we made Denoisec be part of Fiji as well. So I stop sharing my screen if I find my mouse. And Mangal, please. We see your screen. But we don't hear you yet because you're muted. Wonderful.
Yeah. So thank you, Florian. So in this segment, we'll learn how noise to void based denoising can be utilized for better image segmentation. So when we go to the microscope, sorry, my video is having problems. Sorry. Yeah. So when we go to the microscope and we acquire images, often one of the desired readouts is the segmentation of cells and nuclei. And today, the best performing segmentation methods are deep learning based methods. The problem is that deep learning based methods require a lot of ground truth annotations to train the network in the first place. And usually these annotations have to be done manually, and hence it's expensive and only available in small amounts, which means that we'll have to discard most of our raw data for which we do not have the ground truth annotations for. This is undesirable because it's a loss of information, but that's how it is. Another problem that comes from the fact that the images that we acquire are usually noisy. And hence, if we train such a network with raw images, which are noisy and with small amount of data, then it will not generalize so well on unseen test data and it'll produce many mistakes. So we thought, can we do better here? by not discarding all the available raw noisy images for which we do not have ground truth information, but can we use them somehow? And hence we came up with the following idea. So if you remember, the noise to void network, all it needs for training the denoising task is raw noisy images, which are usually available in abundance. So we thought if we could use all our noisy images to train the denoising network, and then could use the features learned via denoising and combine it with a segmentation network, then we may be able to better segment the data even in the presence of less annotations. And hence we combine these two tasks into one single network, which we call the denoising network, which is trained jointly. And during the prediction, it takes a noisy image and produces not only denoised image, but also instance segmentations. But how do you train such a network? In order to train it, the first thing you need is a lot of noisy data, which is usually available, on which we can compute the denoising or the noise to void loss. Remember, we only have few ground truth annotations available, which means we can only compute the segmentation loss for only those images for which we have the ground truth. But instead of discarding all the other raw noisy images, we use them for learning the denoising task. And we combine the denoising task and the segmentation task with this hyperparameter alpha, which tells us how much weighting to give to the denoising task and the segmentation task. And once it has been done in a joint manner, we see some impressive results. So this is a data set from public domain where we have 3,800 raw noisy images, and we only have the ground truth annotations for 10 of those images. And if we train our denoising network in such data limited regime, we see that we do not only do good denoising, but we also perform good segmentations at the same time. So if we compare it to some of the baselines in the literature, we'll find out that denoiseg outperforms the other segmentation baselines, especially in the data limited regimes when we only use little amount of annotated data for training the segmentation part of the network. But the question now here is that how can you use it to train denoiseg for your own data to denoise and segment? So we have to go to this CSB Deep website, which Florian introduced you earlier. And here, under this section, what can I do with my data? If you click this, then it will lead you to all the tools that are available here. And at the bottom of the page, you'll find in the object detection category, the first two examples are for denoiseg. And if you open the page, you'll find that there are many instructions on how to install it for your own computer. And you can also download the code in the form of Jupyter Notebooks using the link here. Once you have downloaded the Jupyter Notebooks, then we can begin the denoiseg workflow. The first step is data generation or data preparation. So in this step, we expect you to have three folders, the first one corresponding to training called train, inside which you'll have two different subfolders, raw, corresponding to all noisy images that you have, and the GT. As you see here, there are many raw noisy images. And if you look inside the GT folder, you'll find that there are only few ground truth annotations. The same holds true for the validation set, which is denoted by the val folder here. And if you look inside the test folder, then you'll find that it only has raw subdirectory, which means this contains only the raw images that you want to denoise and segment, for which we do not have ground truth. And once the data generation is complete, we can move on to the second step, which is the training of denoiseg networks. So for denoiseg network training, we first need to load the data from the training folders and the validation folders, as we saw earlier. And then we can go to our available notebooks. At this point, I'd like to say that when you're in this notebook, and if you already have experience with the noise to void notebooks, as Tim showed you earlier, then I think that you can easily navigate through these notebooks with some intelligent pattern matching. They're very, very similar. So once you have loaded the data, then we can start the training process. So for the training, all we need to do is just configure some parameters. And we have given some default parameters, which we have seen to work well in most of the settings, but you can feel free to play with these parameters. And after the training has been done, we can visualize the validation and training loss. And if they have converged, this means the training has been done successfully. Next is the prediction part. So in the prediction, we show the denoiseg network unseen raw test data, and it predicts four channels: the denoised channel, then the background probability map, the foreground probability map, and the border probability map. But we need instance segmentations. And in order to get instance segmentations, we take the foreground probability map and threshold it. The threshold is computed on the validation set. The threshold is the one with which we get the best segmentation results on the validation set, and we use the same threshold on the foreground channel of our test data predicted by DNoiseSeq. After that, we obtain the binary mask on which we can apply connected component analysis to get instance segmentations. And then we can also visualize our results, both the denoise results as well as the segmentation results. And then we can also export our models to be later used in Fiji, which Deborah will display, show it to you how to use it. And if you have any problems or questions running these notebooks, then you can contact us via the ImageSC forum or the CSBD webpage. And also, if you get some good results with DNoiseSeq on your data, we'd love to hear from you using Twitter or any other medium. Thank you very much, and I'll hand it over to Debo.
Thank you, Mangal. Let me show. I need to stop sharing the screen. Awesome. All right. Let's go back to our website and to available tools and DNoiseSeq that we just talked about. Just so that you know again where to get the resources from I'm talking about. So this is the how to use DNoiseSeq in Fiji link, which goes back to the ImageDay website where you find again installation instructions. It's just the same as for NoiseSeVoyage. You need the CSV Deep update site. And once you got that installed, you can access the DNoiseSeq plugins via plugins, CSV Deep, DNoiseSeq. And there are plugins for prediction and for training. And on the side, on the top, there's an overview which shows what I'm also now going to show you. This is about training, prediction, and there's also one link which is about creating labelings for the training. I will just show you one example of how to do this, and it's also described on this page. Back to Fiji. Let's assume we exported this model in Python. And we are just going again to click File, Import, bioimageio.zip. Now we choose the DNoiseSeq model. And here it is. And now I will open another image of the same data set, which is a bigger, yes. And once you press predict, you will receive an image with four channels. And this is exactly the same as Mangal just described it in Python. The first channel is the denoised input image. The second channel is the probability for the background. The third channel is the foreground probability, and the fourth one, the border. Now, one thing to note here is that these are not binary masks, so we don't automatically threshold anything in ImageJ, but you see this network was trained with actually quite a lot of labeling data, and it's really well able to segment these different states from each other here. So that's why for the probability, which is between zero for no chance that this is border, and one, which is a high chance for border, that this is very well able to see the difference here. All right, and as I promised you, you can also do the training in Fiji. The difference to NoiseSeVoyage is that you need the training data to be organized. I have four folders here, two for the training and two for validation. There's one folder with about 1,000 images, which are noisy, and six labelings where the names correspond between the labeling and the noisy image. And in the labeling, you see that the background is zero, and then each of these objects is labeled with an ID. All right, and now we go to plugins, CSV Deep, DNoiseSeq, and train. And you have to provide now the path to these four folders, which is exactly what I just showed you. About the other advanced options, there was also a question about this. This is described on the website. And we also, Florian mentioned the batch dimension, for example, or the patch shape. This, I have to, for example, I'm training here on my notebook, which has an NVIDIA graphics card with only 2 GB of RAM. So I cannot have a huge batch size or patch shape here. But this, of course, will also affect training. But you can also use these parameters if you don't have a high quality setup. Yes. Just be aware that this might affect the training. I'm keeping all of this like it is. And during training, after the first epoch is done, you will also get a preview window, which looks a bit different than the one in Noise to Void. Here it is. So this is a five tiled image where the first one is the noisy input image, then the denoised image, the tile in the middle, the background probability, then the foreground probability, and last the border probability. And you can nicely follow how well this network is performing. You see in this case that it has some trouble segmenting these two very closely aligning cells. So in this case, I would probably do a few more labelings and try this again. Now, when training is done, I promise you to tell you how to reuse these trained models. So you get two models after training. One is the model which is from the very last training step. This is the one on the left, and the one on the right is the model where the validation loss was lowest. For you can also see this if you go to the training tab of the model. There is a parameter called steps finished, and this should differ between the two models. And for noise to void and denoising, it really makes sense to always use the one from the last training step because we do not have the full ground truth data available here. And in the preview, this is a whole stack of, this is the whole training batch. So you can actually go also during the training through the whole batch and look at different scenarios here. You see that the probability maps here are not clipped between 0 and 1. You see much more about what's happening during the training. If you have any question about this, this might sound a bit obscure now, just read the page or ask me. Now we always get asked how to do labeling. I guess many of you know how to do labeling, but since this question comes up, I will show you the UCLAB way of doing it, which is the LabKit. And LabKit was written by Matthias Arz, who's also from our lab. And LabKit can also do automatic segmentation, but we are now just going to use it to annotate an image. So you install the LabKit update site. This is available in the default list of update sites. Once you got this, you can open your data. I'm just going to open this one here, yes. And then call plugins, segmentation, in LabKit. And LabKit provides you with some drawing tools, which you can now use to annotate your data. So for example, I now choose this pencil here, and then I paint the outline, and then I fill it with the bucket tool. And it makes sense to be very precise here for denoising, so rather make a few labelings which are very precise than doing more which are not precise. This will have a better performance. I'm just storing this labeling because you might want to continue with this whole process later. So here you now see how I'm reopening my data, just starting LabKit again and opening a stored labeling so that you don't have to watch me label this whole thing. Because for denoising, you really have to label the whole image here. This is super important. Don't leave something out. So bear with me as I'm just doing the very last cell here. And once this is done, we can export it via labeling, show labeling in image J. And this is now just a mask where the background is 0 and the foreground is 1, but this is not enough for denoising. we still need the labeling with an object ID per cell. You can, for example, use the 3D objects counter for that. Just make sure that here in the options, you deselect exclude objects from edges so that the whole mask is used. And once you press OK, you now have an image with the real labeling, which you can store to disk and use for the NoiseSec. Now, there was already a webinar by Martin Weigert about Stardust, where he also showed how to do labelings. There's also QPath, I heard, and Pantera, for example, which works really well. Whatever you use, we have, like for our tools, we have heard some love it, some hate it. If you have any feelings about our tools, please let us know, because that's the only way we can improve it. We are not biologists. We are sitting here building the tools and not sitting in the lab actually using it. So if you think this should be useful for you and it's not, please let us know so that we can make it better. And with that, I think we are opening for questions again.
Yes, thank you very much. And I am now going through the questions that are marked for during Q&A, and I will do it in a backwards order. So let's start with the first one. Does the NoiseSec do better than noise to void, or does the NoiseSec replace noise to void when I will use the denoise results for segmentation? Mangal, do you mind answering?
Yeah, sure. So a good question. The answer is, since the denoiseSec networks perform two tasks at the same time, the segmentation and the denoising task, so the network is not doing a dedicated task of denoising alone as it does in noise to void. So it is to be expected that the performance of the network will be slightly worse compared to the noise to void. And this is what we actually see on our data. So on some of the data sets, we see that its performance is almost as good as noise to void. But on some others, it's also slightly worse. Yeah, and we provide a detailed comparison of the same in our paper as well, just for reference. Yeah,
I think it's absolutely right what you say, Mangal. The idea of denoiseSec is, the denoising is a byproduct. And it can be useful, and so we give it back to you, because for many simple data sets, the result will still be very good. But really, the idea of denoiseSec is to give you better segmentation results by letting a network learn how to denoise. And once the network kind of understands where are objects, where are not objects, where are certain structures, and learns how to remove the noise, then somehow this transfers well also in the ability to segment. Because segmentation is somehow a very extreme form of denoising, right? Where you say zero to the whole background and one to everything foreground. And so since these two types of tasks are so related, we figured that doing them jointly might actually help. And it turns out that if you have very little data labeled in this regime, where you are kind of bored of making circles around objects, then doing it together with a lot of noisy data and then profiting from the network learning how to denoise in order to do also better for segmentation makes actually a lot of sense. And this is exactly where I would see fit for this method, if this is your use case. But is it a very young method? So if you happen to try it and you are not satisfied, let us know. If you happen to try it and you are very satisfied, please let us know as well. At the moment, we would just be very happy to get feedback on this method and see where is the strength, where should we kind of maybe improve it, where is it useful for people in the wild. Okay, next Q&A question. What is the segmentation part of the NoiseSec based on? Stardust? Who would like to give it a go?
Anyone could. I mean, did you?
Yeah, want no, to? No, no, no.
Okay. Okay. So at the moment, it's based on three class unit, where the three classes are foreground class, background class, and the border class. But in principle, actually, if you just look at the theory, there's nothing which says that it should be restricted to three class unit. And it could well be applied to Stardust or any
actually,
other,
yeah. One of your papers at ISPRI this year is showing in a non-joint setup, like the predecessor of denoiseSec, we also show that if you first train a denoising network and then a Stardust, on top of it, that also actually leads to positive results. But denoiseac, as it is at the moment in CSBD, but as you can download it and use it, as Mangal said, does a three-class unit segmentation. Okay. I think I read somewhere that CARE can be used like the label-free prediction, FNET, from Allen Institute, to artificially label 2D bright field images. Is this correct? I will answer, yes, it is. If you give bright field as an input, and then as ground truth image, you give a fluorescence image, and these two images are very well aligned, right? Then a CARE network can very well train to predict the expression of this fluorescence marker. This being said, we tried that in multiple courses we gave around the world with more than one person having this idea, and results were actually really good. CARE was never intended to do this. It can do it because for many pairs of bright field and fluorescence, there is a statistical correlation that the unit can pick up on. If you really want to do that at a professional level, I would go with the methods that are published for this purpose, right? But nothing stops you from giving it a try in CARE, and if the results are good enough, then be our guest, right? It's actually, every time a student tries and we get good results, I find it very exciting, but it is not the original intention of CARE. I don't understand why you go to all the trouble to make these models available through BioImage.io, but then tell people not to use them on their own data. Am I missing something? Maybe. So the model zoo is not intended to be a model zoo only for CARE and noise to void and denoiseac models. It is intended to be a model zoo for all bioimage analysis models that make sense. And for example, the Stardist in 2D has trained models that translate very well on a number of different data sets. And for segmentation, this is in general maybe better transferable. But also the people, our colleagues from Elastic, use the model zoo and will use the model zoo more and more to distribute some models that you can then use either within Elastic or just within PyTorch. And in general, it is just a marketplace for models that can be used or reused. So how, if you are in a facility and you create a model for someone, of course you can go with a memory stick to that person and hand the model over. But if there is an automated, like in the cloud solution via a model zoo, that of course adds to the convenience of the users, right? And so we are trying to build the model zoo in such a way that all these use cases, reuse, but also just transfer, are actually covered. And there was another Nubia seminar by the Deep Image J people. I think it was actually with the Deep Image J people, and they have very, very similar mindset here. So to make a long story, even longer, I end this question by saying, we don't know exactly what the model zoos will do in 5 years' time, because we are just about to build them and the world has to wiggle itself in place, right? But everything I said before are good possibilities, and we are eager to find out what are the most convenient ways that people will want to use the model zoo. And also we are still figuring out what models can be transferred and how can we ensure that nothing unexpected happens. Tim, I think you raised your hand. I'm happy if you chip in.
Yes, one other important use case for a model zoo is reproducibility. If you have an experiment and you train your network and you write the paper, you want to have people be able to look at your data and also get the model you trained on this data. And the model zoo provides this kind of framework that you can publish also your model.
You get essentially a unique identifier. And you know, if I download this model, it is to the last epsilon exactly the model that was used on this data. The model zoo will also contain all the metadata to the data that it was trained on and to the data it was applied on. So in principle, you can 100% reproduce the result. And that is, of course, as Tim pointed out, positive as well. Okay. I think I forgot one question, but we will...
Florian, sorry. So I'm sorry to cut out your enthusiasm, but I think it's time to go for the final outlook. And I remember all the participants, we will post every answer in the forum so we can feed them.
I was just about to say that I forgot one question, but I will not answer it now in the interest of time. And we will now move on to the very last part, which is just a small look into the future by Alex, because you might have noticed the whole care thing popped up just a few years ago. And since then, many of these methods kind of came one after another. And it is not that we end now, but in the next year, you can expect that many additional tools will be ingested into the CSP Deep and brought to you, and they already exist in the research realm, and Alex will quickly give us a heads up on what you can expect in the next few months to come.
Hey, so yeah, this is for me the most exciting part because I get to tell you about what we're currently doing research-wise. So yeah, if you're a little bit patient, you can experience these tools in the same way as the ones that we've discussed today in more detail. So I have to share my screen again. All right. What are the next steps, in particular with respect to unsupervised denoising? So one thing that I want to quickly talk to you about is probabilistic noise to void. This is something where we try to improve upon the noise to void I've talked about earlier. We've published this earlier this year, but it's not yet part of this CSP Deep collection that we've seen today. But there is code for it and you can find it. So if we look at the original denoising problem and we have an example image like this, and we apply a traditional care network that we train on this data and then use it to denoise it, we get quite a nice result looking like this. And now if you compare this to a noise to void result, you can be a little bit disappointed, both with respect to PSNR, where this is a measure of the quality, higher is better, and also visually. Yeah, and there was previously the question about, can we see the PSNR differences? And yes, so I think we can see it. And unfortunately, it doesn't look as nice as the traditional care. So why is this? I mentioned this earlier before. So we are not making use of the full information because we are restricting ourselves to using this blind spot receptive field. But here I show you already the solution to this, which is probabilistic noise to void. And probabilistic noise to void allows us really to narrow this gap between the supervised care and the unsupervised noise to void methods. And I can just give you a brief intuition here on how it really works. So we still use a blind spot network, but here we don't use it to predict a value for each pixel, but instead we predict a probability distribution for each pixel, a distribution over possible signals at the pixel. We combine this with a probabilistic model for the imaging noise. By doing so, we can reintroduce this missing information that we are excluding by using the blind spot. And we can produce much improved results. So if you compare this to traditional training, in traditional training, you have one network, which is a black box. And then probabilistic noise to void, you have now two components. You have the blind spot network, but you also have this noise model that you need. Now, from the applicability side of things. So in care training, when you do a new experiment, let's say you label your sample differently, you have to retrain your network for this new data because the statistics have changed. And unfortunately, you also have to go back to the microscope and acquire new paired training data of this type. Now in PN2V, you also have to retrain your blind spot network, but you can again use the very same data that you want to denoise to train it again. You don't have to acquire additional training data. But what about this noise model? Well, this is something that really depends only on your detector. So if your detector settings are the same, you have to measure this only once and then you can reuse it. So the second exciting thing
I want to talk to you about is what we call diff noising, and this is super new. You can find it on archive at the moment. And here we want to denoise in a new, different way, providing diverse solutions that account for the uncertainty in our data. So I know that in all likelihood, a lot of you have data that looks roughly like this, which is like just horribly noisy and you can hardly tell what's inside there. And we have to admit that. So we cannot be sure what is really the true signal that led to this input, even as humans, right? Now, this is the true ground truth, but we don't know it. So, and if we train a network, whichever network we use, if we use CARE or N2V or PN2V, this network will have to make a compromise in its predictions in the end. And it will produce something like this, what we call an MMSE estimate, which is essentially a compromise between all the possible different solutions that might explain the noisy input. And you can see this, the network is, for example, here, not sure, is this really an N or is it maybe an H, right? Or is this a U or is it maybe two I's, right, with the dots here. So we don't really know it. And the result is this compromise, which would never occur in reality, right? This is not nice. So in diff noising, we've come up with a way to train a system to provide to you not one estimate, but to allow you to sample a lot of estimates that all could explain this input. So we can explain the same image in a lot of different ways. And interestingly, you can combine all these hypotheses by simply averaging, and this will actually produce the same type of estimate that N2V or CARE would give you for the same data. But obviously the most interesting thing is how can we use all these diverse solutions downstream? For example, if you want to do detection or segmentation or whatever we want to measure on the data. And this is, I think, a very exciting prospect. So here we've applied this to a bunch of real microscopy data. And I show here only two sampled hypotheses from the system, but we could easily generate 10,000 of those, right? We are only showing two of you today. And I want to illustrate here that starting out with this horribly noisy input, we really don't know what exactly is going on. We get really diverse solutions that might explain the same data if you compare these two. Now here it's really diverse in this case because there's really a ton of noise. If you look at this example, there is less uncertainty because there's less noise. And this means that the sampled outputs are also closer together and not as diverse, but still we can see here subtle differences in the sampled results. Yeah, with this, I want to say thank you to all the co-authors who've contributed to the project that we talked about today, and also to the UCLAB in general. And a special thanks here goes out to the software engineers that allow us to really make this available to you as a more usable type of solution instead of like research quality annoying code that you have to fight your way through. So yeah, lastly, also, I want to say thank you to the facilities at MPI CBG, the LMF and the computer department, which allow us to do this work. So thanks for your attention. I think we go back to the final round of questions.
Can you stop sharing the screen? Then I will, I think Rocco could potentially help us to understand how much time is remaining, but I think
I'm sorry to say nothing. So we can of course overrun if attendees they are interested, and just address few questions. And there is a message from Julian about New Bias Academy.
Okay, let me first wrap up, and this will only take 30 seconds. So if this was all overwhelming for you, the suggested entry points are the website. You will find a lot of things there, right? We saw it also, many of the speakers today went from the website to the examples. So many links should be there. But if this is at some point not enough, you have other questions, you have problems, go to the image J forum, to the forum.image.sc and ask your question there. And this actually is good advice, not only in the context of CSPD, but in general for bioimage analysis. It's a very vivid young community, very friendly people, many, many tools are there. So if you have an analysis question, it might very well be that some Fiji guru gives you one possible answer, while somebody from QPath or a Python-centric person gives you a different solution or potential solution. So I can only, if you are not already a member of this, if this vibrant community, suggest you to get there and make friends there, because it's a really great group of people. And then I want to just also say thanks to all the speakers of today. We put out a lot of new versions of codes, website, everything happened overnight in the last few days. It was absolutely exhilarating, which is just like the PI word for exhausting. We also want to thank the people that we work very closely with on some of the methods we presented today, and also the labs with which we work together on the Model Zoo and similar initiatives at the moment. I could thank 1,000 people more, but first of all, I would always forget somebody, so I draw a line just here and end this presentation, and the Nubias people will now tell me how we continue.
Okay, thanks, Florian. So this is Julien speaking. I'll just have a very short message, probably 30 seconds, to just inform like the people who are still here that Nubias Academy would actually take a break for the summer. So this was the last webinar of a long and very successful series. Thanks to Florian and the team for actually closing it with such a nice webinar. So just to inform you, like over the last 3 months, more than 10,000 people have registered to these webinars. So we consider it like a very nice success. And actually the feedback from everyone was overwhelming. The only purpose of this message is to actually thank the people who are behind it and name them. So I will just name them bluntly and linearly in alphabetic order of their family name. So we want to thank Rocco D'Antuono, Olivier Bury, Bram van den Berg, Fabrice Cordelier, Elna Spazelli, Ofra Golani, Romain Guillet, Robert Hase, Anna Clem, Florian Levet, Marion Louveau, Cota Miura, Paula Sampaio, Mafalda Souza, and Christian Tischer. All these people have been working hard in the background, behind the scenes to actually make it work. So the idea is to be back in September with a new list and new formats, hopefully by mid end of September. So from now, if you want and if people want to stay, then you can actually address questions and answers further on until you get bored.
Okay, so I think if I see it right, all the questions in the Q&A window are currently answered or not copied over into the system that we are working on. If that's the case, how did you know? I think there is maybe one that I can read out loud by Christian Tischer, actually. I should not say that, but it is him. Looks like you are using different ideas for segmentation than in Stardist. If that's the case, how would Denoisec compare to Stardist? That's a very good question. I would expect that in many, many cases, Stardist would produce better results. Because Stardist is a very versatile segmentation model, but there is this one window where you have very, very little annotations on an otherwise very large data set. You have maybe a few gigabytes of noisy images, hopefully very noisy, because this is where the Denoisec will do best. And you have only a few labels. I think in this regime, the Denoisec might be useful. Additionally, it is a bit different in what output it produces. While Stardist gives you star convex shapes, Denoisec gives you these foreground, background, and border probabilities. So that might, depending on what you want to do with these outputs downstream, also enable you to feed it into different tools and do different things with it, right? I have little reason to believe that denoising will give you vastly better results than Stardist. I think it's more the contrary, in fact. So I was waiting until somebody asked another question, but I'm also the person having to find out what questions to ask. I'm not sure if there's also, Rocco, if there's also a possibility now that we are like in overtime, right? That people could also just raise a hand and ask questions live, because I would be happy to, you know, like.
If you wish so, they can signal it, they can write in the chat and we will do it.
So if you want to kind of speak up, signal it, and Rocco might give you the microphone, the virtual microphone. Otherwise, let me quickly check. I think there is something else here. Does denoising better? I know this we had already. Can I use denoising for 3D data? Only after coming to the UGLAB and doing an internship or using it as a research. So nothing makes this impossible except the non-existence of the source code that would do it. So there is no fundamental problem with it, unless you think that not being able to do it in this current real world is a fundamental problem. Okay, I'm not sure if you get me, but it would need us to kind of put this method in the 3D realm. And this is manpower, person power that has to put into the project at some point. I really dearly hope that it would happen, but it did not happen in the past. So the answer is potentially yes. And if you happen to have time and you want to do it, then I invite you to hook up with us and make it happen. Maybe you are looking for a master's thesis or whatever. That might be a good occasion to do such a project, bachelor's thesis.
So this could be the first webinar of September if you are able to get this result.
Sure.
Yeah, and so with that, I think that's all. And I thank again all the speakers and UGLAB for joining in so such a number and with great contribution on all the aspects of this topic. So thanks again. We will stop recording. We will also please ask the participant to go out of the webinar or accept that we'll exclude them. And thanks again for participating.
I thank also you. And the whole Nubias crew for making this wonderful and very valuable events, and also including us and giving us a chance to showcase some of the tools that we are involved in generating. We are very appreciative of not only these events, but of Nubias in general. I think it's absolutely a great addition to our research fields.